Britain's young drivers are some of the most dangerous in Europe. One in every three drivers who die on UK roads is 25 or under. One in 10 young people have been in a crash that has resulted in death or serious injury. One in five young drivers has a crash within 6 months of passing their test. In this series, we're following inexperienced teens
110, this is.
To see what they're really like behind the wheel.
Bloody hell!
Fasten your seatbelts, because each week two novices will be let loose on the road in their family car.
I drive so much better when I'm a little bit tipsy.
They believe we're filming a slice of modern teenage life.
Come on, are you even pushing?
But in fact, it's all about their driving.
What are you doing?
My flimmin' car.
And what they don't know is that their parents will be watching their every manoeuvre. The cars are fitted with state-of-the-art cameras and a hidden telemetry recorder that secretly tracks their every move.
She's posing!
Oh my god!
Each teen will go on three road trips, geared towards testing every aspect of their driving.
Shouldn't have drank that much.
And at the end of it all, aided and abetted by a former traffic cop, the parents will have a decision to make.
Two bets of speeding.
I would have given him a ticket.
If they don't like the way the teens operate behind the wheel, both of them could end up with advanced driving lessons. But if they think they're good enough, we'll give the parents the cash to buy their kid a car they can call their very own. Tonight, we meet two very different characters. Tommy, who thinks he can give Lewis Hamilton a run for his money.
Move, mate.
And Chantelle, a prime candidate for anger management.
What's he doing?
Get out of the car now.
Will it be the reward or retribution for either of these teens when their parents see them behind the wheel?
I went happy and I went happy with her. I really hard to keep my mouth shut.
It's really not an easy decision for me.
Shocking, I think.
Welcome to Barely Legal Drivers.
Smash yourself.
This is 19-year-old Chantelle Jeffries from Bristol. She lives at home with her dad Mike and her brother Kieran. When tragedy hit the family several years ago, Chantelle was forced to grow up fast.
My mum died when I was 9.
It's been a bit of like a daddy's girl. But being a single parent with her, it was only so much the feminine side I could tap into.
When I was younger, I used to clam up a bit and, like, get really upset.
I don't know how much it's really... her mum's death affected Chantelle. She bottles it up. I try to talk to Chantelle about it, but sometimes, and I wish she would.
I've never tried looking for sympathy on it. If anything, I don't want people to know.
Express yourself.
All of which may explain her approach to life.
If I want to do something, I'll do it, whether people think it's good or not.
Chantelle's a girl with attitude, especially when it comes to driving.
What a silly prick!
Dickhead!
My driving is really erratic. It's very, get out the way, I'm the only one on the road.
Why is he waiting?
And if anyone's in my way, I'll just go mental.
She had a car, but racked up £2,000 worth of parking tickets and sold it for 2 bottles of champagne. Let's hope it was vintage.
It didn't even have central locking or, like, electric windows. It had wind-down windows. So if I wanted to give it the big one, I'd have to go... wind it down. This wouldn't happen if I had a Range Rover.
Chantelle's attitude at the moment really needs to change. Her attitude towards other drivers, towards responsibility towards her own vehicle, that needs looking at before Chantelle gets another car. She's a nice kid, but her head's up her ass, so...
Sexy and I know it.
Down on the south coast in sunny Hastings, 19-year-old Tommy Vora is also busy loving life. Uni student Tommy has 3 loves: birds, booze, and boxing.
Oh, Tommy's quite a character and quite a handful. He loves to go out and he loves all the banter and he loves chatting up girls.
I'd say I'm confident, a little bit cocky. Obviously, I'm good at pulling girls.
While Tommy has plenty of success with the ladies, he's been less than lucky on the road.
The whole driving thing, I do enjoy driving. I think I'm a safe driver. But I went out one night, I was driving through the lanes, some blokes come around the corner to me, I swerve, and I've obviously ripped my car off.
He didn't tell us, did he?
Yeah.
I knew there was something wrong, because I'm on the same sort of wave band.
Yeah. Tommy's desperate to get his hands on a car again.
Having used the car would be good, obviously, for taking girls out and obviously just taking my mates everywhere as well.
While he's behind the wheel of the family car, his parents will be watching his every move.
I think it's going to be a bit shocking and a bit uncomfortable to see some of the things that he gets up to.
I think he'll be all right. He'll be sensible in his own way.
Do you mean with his driving?
Driving and everything, yeah.
And everything,
yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
I wish I had your confidence.
If Tommy and Chantelle show they're ready, they could both be heading off into the sunset in their own set of wheels. In Bristol, Chantelle's dad, Mike, is busying himself in the kitchen, preparing the family supper.
Is it going to take long? Because I'm really, really hungry.
Wait, 5 minutes, if you don't. Just wait for the...
Oh, I died.
Patience doesn't exactly look like her strong point. Round the table, the chat turns to Chantelle's finances.
I'll break your payday loans and all that. You still got them? Oh, and another thing as well.
I swear, you're only happy when you have money.
You're only nice to me when I buy you stuff.
Yeah, but that's all right, it's different.
A bit like that with you and me, don't it? Mm. You can have a lot of money, Chantal, can't you, by the age of 30? If you want to be a business people save money, and that's how they start off.
You should start saving to most.
All right, Martin Lewis, over there.
It's time for Mike to grudgingly hand over the keys to his beloved rust bucket.
Right, responsible. That means don't go calling anybody else W's. It's my car, it might be a shitty car, but it works, unlike yours, all right? If you just waste all the money on shit, like these scarves and all that, then you might look forward to owning, right? That's chance. Sort yourself out. All right, lad?
Thanks.
Love you, Liz.
What Chantelle doesn't know is that she has a week of driving her dad's car to prove that she's responsible enough to own her own motor. In Hastings, Tommy's having a final family dinner.
You're going to miss me tomorrow when I go.
Yeah, I'll miss you very much. We were just saying that in the kitchen.
Tomorrow, he'll be driving himself and best mate Fraser the hour and a quarter to Canterbury University in Mum's car.
Yeah, well, you make sure that you allow enough time, Tom, because that road is so dangerous.
I'll be fine.
I know you don't.
Tommy's already had a year studying, but decided to change course and restart.
This is your opportunity to do well at uni.
It's your year.
I know. Yeah, I know. Look what happened.
Yeah, all right, you're there for have a good time.
Yeah.
Honestly, there to study.
This is your year, darling,
rich,
to do well.
If you turn up for it.
I'm sure he will.
Yes.
You'll be absolutely fine.
You'll be fine.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Okay. You're gonna miss me, yeah?
Yeah, of course. No. We'll all miss you and we'll love you.
No, you're giving me up for money.
Yeah.
Well, that'd be the usual.
Early the next morning, best mate Fraser has arrived for a lift and Tommy has handed the keys to Maggie's car.
Now, you drive really carefully in that car,
right, yeah,
Tommy.
You know I will. You need to trust me, yeah? You need to start trusting me, yeah?
I do trust you.
Exactly.
It's just that I know how easy it is to slip into yeah. You know, a bit of silliness. But you take care in that car.
Tommy's first road trip, one of three that his parents will be watching, is from Hastings to Canterbury, a distance of 47 miles. It should take the boys an hour and 15 minutes, assuming they stick to the speed limit.
Here we go, boy.
To you and you, mate.
Yeah.
Buzzing, bro.
Oh, yeah, boy. Well excited, mate.
Cannot wait to get there.
Yeah. Oh, mate, it's going to be so good.
Yeah, back to you and your mate, it's going to be sick.
I'm going to hurt some feelings this year as well.
It's Tommy Vora,
the heartbreaker.
You know it.
Half an hour into the journey and Tommy, heartbreaker Vora, has an idea.
Get a condom pulled out the window and it blows up.
Yeah, it's huge.
It's huge,
in the car?
Yeah. Have you got one with you now?
I actually do.
Hey, do it. You want to hold it? Like that. Really far.
If both his hands are holding the condom, what's he using to steer?
Oh, the games that we play out here.
If nothing else, it proves Tommy knows more about safe sex than safe driving. However, Tommy's first trip is completed without any speeding at all. He and Fraser arrive in Canterbury in one piece. The next day in Hastings, Tommy's parents sit down to watch their little angel's first journey. This is the start of Maggie and AJ's mission to determine whether or not Tommy deserves his own car.
Right, you ready for this?
Go on then, let's go for it. See what that little sod's been up to.
You want to hold it? Like that?
Oh my God!
I'm not very happy about that.
Oh my God!
That's not very nice, is it?
Disappointed, but not surprised. And I still think he came over as being fairly sweet, even though he was being disgusting.
Yeah.
Two more to come. I think it's probably going to be downhill all the way.
Luckily, Maggie and AJ won't be alone in deciding whether Tommy gets his own car or more lessons. Former traffic cop Judith Roberts is also watching Tommy's driving. With 20 years' experience on the force, Judith's job is to help and advise Tommy's parents at the end of the week.
I think Tommy's driven quite well. He hasn't broken the speed limit and he's taken control of the vehicle quite nicely. However, the worst thing he did on the drive was to mess about with a condom. Not only is it distracting to himself, but it's also distracting to other drivers. I think if Tommy's going to have his own vehicle, we need to see how he gets on in the next two journeys.
Condom gate aside, the drive itself was pretty smooth, and Tommy's manoeuvred himself into a good position to get the car. Over in Thornbury, Chantelle's getting ready for her first trip. Despite the debt debate at dinner last night, she's going to a car showroom to gawp at Katie Price's favourite car, the Range Rover. It may be way out of her price range, but if idle Katie's got one, Chantelle wants one.
She's got to lint all the fur off me as well. Right, done!
Chantelle's picking up best mate Gabby, who lives close to the city centre. From there, she'll take the M32 out of Bristol. To get to the showroom in Wootton-under-Edge, she needs to take the M4, then M5 north. She doesn't know the way, so how's she going to cope with the pressure? Straight out of the gates, and Chantelle's wolfing down her breakfast with one hand whilst trying to drive with the other. And there's no seatbelt.
Oh no, I've dropped a sandwich!
Oops, the mobile's out. Eyes on the road.
All right, I'm about 2 minutes away. All right, okay, I'll be there in 7.
All right, bye-bye-bye.
Hello, I got your sandwich.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, but I dropped it.
Now off to the showroom.
Has actually made me appreciate driving so much.
Yeah.
Pass me my lipstick!
It's like the fucking Bahamas in here.
She's putting on lippy on the motorway.
This one is for the boys.
Lost, Chantelle decides to call the showroom for directions. That's 3 points on the old licence.
I don't have a clue where I'm going. I don't know how to guess because I have no sense of direction. God.
Still lost, both girls try the maps on their phones. Not a good idea.
Right, it is next to... What the fuck? Am I going the right way?
Yeah, it's the next junction. We just went past
15.
Ah, sorted then.
Oh, I wouldn't have spotted that.
Is that junction 14?
We're going to Wales! Oh my Shine!
Oh dear. Somehow they avoid a trip to a different country. Then, more by luck than judgment.
Is this it? Yeah!
Yeah! Yeah! Yeah!
Finally, having taken twice as long as it should, Chantelle and Gabby arrive at the Range Rover showroom.
Oh my, I think I'm going to throw up.
Please
look
don't.
At that.
There. Look at the white one.
Actually, my breath actually gets taken away. Is that wrong? Oh my God. Oh. So this car's 58 grand.
That's like...
I think what I'll have to do is just not go out for a couple of nights a week and just stop going to Nando's. I actually want this car. This is amazing.
The next day, Dad Mike sneaks out to his friend's house to watch the first drive. With three daughters, darts champion Mark Dudbridge is the perfect person to help Mike.
You know, one side of me is thinking that, you know, she's going to be a bit of a liability on the road, but I really, really want her to be,
yeah,
to be good, to be careful. You know, it's like, you know, you and me, pal, and I want the best for her. It's going to be really interesting.
Oh, no. Don't answer the phone.
I've never heard my daughter swear like that. I've never, about four or five, absolutely disgusted at her language.
So what's she looking at now? Is she texting?
She is, she's texting.
She's texting.
Fucking Everett, what's he doing?
Watching this, it's a bit upsetting because I just think she's, I don't know.
Well, it must be upsetting for you.
Needs to grow up a bit.
I don't have a clue where I'm going.
She's on the phone again. Oh, that was awful, mate. Her language is disgusting. The phone use is wrong, putting the makeup on. It's not right. The cursing of other people. I wouldn't be proud of myself if I see myself a bit like that.
Former traffic cop Judith Roberts is also watching the first journey.
She's a nightmare. This is not the behaviour, really, for any driver, regardless of the fact that she's a new driver. My biggest issue is her and her phone. I think probably, if given time, she'll probably settle down and be a bit more comfortable in the car.
With eating, putting makeup on and using her mobile, after her first road trip, it's looking like a real uphill struggle for Chantelle to get the car. Coming up later on, Tommy's driving is tested right to the limits.
He had more than two glasses.
Hang on, I think we got the wrong way.
And Chantelle gets lost again.
What? Fucking Morrison's again!
I give up.
Back in Canterbury, and it's halfway through Tommy's week-long test drive. But tonight, he's got a night off from driving. Tommy's hitting the town with housemates Fraser, who we've met, Ollie, who we haven't, and Ryan, whom we'll meet later on.
Are you a USA?
No, you're never, ever going to have a dull night when you go out with Tommy. Look at the kid's bum. My name is tattooed on the top right.
That's right. Tommy has 11 boys' names tattooed on his bum. With pre-drinks consumed, Tommy and his boys are off to one of Canterbury's top night spots. Open Gangnam Style. The boys get straight down to business. Ah, there's housemate Ryan.
Absolutely crazy night. All my boys smashed, I'm smashed. I don't think anyone can be as drunk as we are at this moment. As soon as we get back in there, girls.
And Tommy proves that he's a man of his word. The club's over, but not the night, because it's all back to Tommy's. But while the booze and the banter is flying around, it's obvious that it's not just Tommy's parents that are worried about him. There's also friend Emily.
I was like, she was
you
like,
oh, have lectures tomorrow, though.
I have Thursdays off.
He hasn't actually been to any of his lectures since they've started. But I think he tells his mum that he does a lot more than he does. He does tend to go out a lot, three, four times a week. and normally the rest of us are in. He might come across as really sort of arrogant and really like stupid and stuff like that, but deep down he is a really lovely guy and I know he can really work hard. He just got to put his mind to it.
What is it, Tommy?
In the mirror. Oh my god, I'm so big. Tommy! Thomas, no, Thomas, stop grabbing the tits.
Sorry, Mum.
No!
Tommy, please, stop it.
In Bristol, it's midway through the week, and the girls meet up for a much quieter get-together than Tommy's. They share a special bond, as 2 years ago, Gabby also lost her mum.
I don't think my mum would be proud of my spending habits.
I don't think they really look at it like they would not be proud of us.
I don't know, I reckon I would have been worse off if my mum was alive now. She'd like, oh God. She'd make our lives hell.
Anyone that ever met my mum was just like... like, yeah. They just didn't have anything bad to say about her. She felt really sorry for me and it's like...
That's the thing, I don't want people to feel sorry for me because I don't care. So I don't want people to be like...
I think you must care a little bit.
Like, people are like, oh, you can always talk to me, but no one knows, do they? Like, no one... like, unless you've done it or unless you've been through something, like, no one knows, so... It's like refreshing, like talking to you about it because I know that you know.
Chantelle's bottled up all her problems for years, and now she's finally talking about her issues. A couple of days later in Canterbury, boxing mad Tommy and his mates are off to London to watch a professional bout. Canterbury to central London is a distance of 63 miles, a journey that should take approximately 1 hour and 40 minutes in normal weather. But the weather is anything but normal.
I hate fucking weather, boys. Weather's shit.
Small town boy Tommy will have to navigate around one of the world's busiest cities safely, deal with the peer pressure of driving a car full of mates, and be sensible with his drinking once he gets there.
Tommy, mate, where's the power?
In it, driving a little bit slow.
Mate, seriously?
I'm going to go on the motorway, I'm going to bomb it.
Tommy, have you got your headlights on?
Yeah. You sure?
100%, mate.
All right, sweet.
Tommy,
mate.
What are you playing at? I'm trying to fucking drive, mate. But speed up, come on.
In it.
Look, there's an empty lane to your right.
Generally cannot see shit.
I can, there's a nice white van in front. A few road signs. Am I going left?
No, 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 Tommy!
Boy! I'm in a fucking bus lane, mate. Oh my god.
Fucking hell.
Sauce, mate!
Having ignored his friend's needling on the motorway, Tommy and the boys arrive safely at the venue.
Again, yeah!
Boxing and booze go hand in hand, so Tommy and Fraser head off to the bar. But before Tommy needs to decide whether to have a drink or not, there's a problem.
Bring any cash, I'm ready for my card. And I don't mean I take card.
No beers tonight then. It's a lucky escape.
Sick night, bro.
It's after midnight, with a wet, clear motorway, and Tommy has his mates to deal with again.
Sorry, I didn't know my nan was driving.
Speed up, come on.
Definitely need to speed up, big time.
How can I speed up, mate?
Speed up.
Put your foot down on the...
on the accelerator there.
Yeah, both, mate. Tommy, if you got 100, you're going to get a 10.
Just do it, just do it. Look.
No, mate.
A 100? Ryan, you owe Tommy a 10.
Tommy's buckled. Hitting a ton in wet conditions may have impressed his mates, but will it be a setback to getting his own car? The next day in Hastings, halfway through the week, and Maggie and AJ are preparing to watch more of Tommy's shenanigans. First up, it's his non-driving night out at the club in Canterbury.
What's he doing?
She's a pretty girl. Oh my God, there's a different one.
Another
oh my
one.
God, it's another one. Oh my God, don't these girls mind that he's been snogging all the others?
No.
Shocking.
Shocking, I think. It is, isn't it?
Absolutely.
He hasn't actually been to any of his lectures.
Thomas just wants to play, doesn't he, all the time?
I know. Well, he's going to have to grow up, isn't he, and stop mucking about like that, because that's just over the top.
In the mirror. Oh, my God, I'm so vain. Tommy! Oh, Thomas! Thomas, stop grabbing the tits.
Sorry, Mum. Sorry, Mum.
And then Tommy's second trip, in his mum's car full of mouthy mates and in treacherous conditions.
Not very sensible, is it? But, you know, it's a car full of lads, isn't it? They're just being totally stupid. Yeah. I think he's doing well. It's a lot of responsibility driving, isn't it, in that weather? I think Tommy would be well ready to have his own car again, the way he's driving.
His drive's been very good, yeah. Apart from everybody encouraging him to go faster.
100! Right, you owe Tommy a tenner.
Even though he was speeding a bit on the way back, I don't think that's excessive speeding. If you told me he was doing 120 miles an hour, then I would be concerned.
I'll be the same. I was taking the fast lane and just go for it.
Well, that's obviously where he's got it from, then. His father's bad habits, so we'll blame you, dear. Yeah.
With Tommy's mum and dad having made their views on speeding known, it's time for former traffic cop Judith's verdict.
On the way to London, I thought Tommy drove very well. It's difficult conditions, difficult driving conditions. He had a car full of friends that were trying to distract him, but he remained calm and in control of the vehicle. What's let him down is the return journey. Although it's late at night and on the motorway, he's driven at over 100 miles an hour, which if he'd been caught would have been an automatic ban. It's a very difficult decision for me to make now. I'm very much on the fence with this one. We'll have to wait and see how his final drive pans out.
An automatic ban isn't the only problem. Stopping distances at 100 are almost double what they'd be if he was going at the legal limit of 70. With only one drive left, Tommy will need to prove himself more responsible if he's got any chance of getting his hands on that car. Back at the Vora household, Maggie and AJ are shocked by Tommy's general behaviour, and it's made AJ think.
I find it very difficult the way he's treating the girls and behaving. 90% of my time I spend at work. And I've never been a father figure to my sons.
Bit sad. Well, because I think you've missed out.
I know I missed out, yeah. If I can turn the clocks back 15 years and start again, I would love to do that. I would like us to get together and say, like, Dad, let's go for a pint and things like that. It'd be great.
In Bristol, it's time for Chantelle's second drive.
Morning. Woke up and I'm ill.
Ill or not, she's off to one of England's most famous sporting venues, Goodwood, for an afternoon at the races with best friend Gabby. Their chat 2 days ago has made Chantelle think a lot about her behaviour and her relationships with other people.
I've got a really big bunch of friends. I think Gabby's the only one that I'd really go to and, like, really get upset to. I mean, I could be close to anyone, but it takes a lot for me to trust someone. And most of the time, I just don't bother trusting people because at the end of the day, like, they'll do you over anyway.
Chantelle's definitely dealt with quite a lot, or maybe hasn't dealt with quite a lot, but that makes her pretty tough. Like, it's pretty hard to get through that exterior. It's easier for her to emotionally connect with a dress that she really wants or some designer stuff because she doesn't have to, like, answer any questions to it. Like, I love my range, I love my scarf, I love... rather than actually talking about someone or something.
Hello. All right.
From Bristol to Goodwood Racecourse is a distance of 142 miles. It should take the girls 3 hours. It's going to be the longest drive of her life. Will she be able to keep her concentration?
Waiting
have a valid GPS signal? Is it joking me?
They've borrowed a GPS to avoid getting lost again.
Charging battery? The fuck? Fuck! What a twat! What an idiot! Fucking get out of the car now.
Shut up.
What an idiot! What's he doing? The twat.
Oh God, I hate bodies. Fuck off.
The girls have found their way out of Bristol and are finally on the correct motorway. So the mood quickly changes.
We're on the M4! Woo!
An hour in and she seems confident on the motorway. So she's having a three-course meal. Followed by some calorie-crunching armchair aerobics.
What?
Have it. Have it,
it's always a good time. Whoa!
Her hands seem to be spending more time off the wheel than on it. Unsure of her route and with the GPS still not working, suddenly her mobile phone rears its ugly head.
West Hampnet. Where the fuck is that? My voice is getting really bad now.
Do you want me to do it for you?
Calculating room, apparently.
Hang on, did she just pass over her phone?
Take exit 13 onto 834 towards Oxford Newbury.
Having changed their outfits en route, the girls are now just 5 miles from the racecourse, and Chantelle's completely reliant on Gabby's directions.
Right, so head E on A27. Fucking lost and late.
Finally, after a mammoth 5 hours on the road for what should have been a 3-hour journey.
I can see the races!
The races have already started, but they're here and the sun is shining, so who cares? Time to put on a bet.
Made a million, I want that one.
Oh, Edge of Glory.
Who knows, that Katie Price Range Rover could become a reality.
I just heard a bloke go 5, definitely number 5, and he had a pint in his hand.
A pint? Well, he must know what he's talking about.
Oh my God!
They're number 7! Oh, we're gonna flop.
Race is over. And with empty pockets, it's time to make the long journey back home to Bristol. The next day, Mike's back at Mark's to watch Chantelle's second car trip.
Waiting for a valid GPS signal? Is it... joking me? Charging battery? The fuck? I don't know where I'm going!
Who's driving? Fuck it. Hang on a minute. Chantelle still made the same mistakes, you know, a couple of times had her hands off the wheel in...
The language is obviously...
still an issue.
Yeah, it's not great, but then again, that don't make her a bad driver, or don't make her a bad person, I suppose, but... I think now, somebody could just teach her a lesson about using that mobile phone.
Well, I'm pretty sure she's going to watch it on now, and with the traffic officer's advice, she'd probably never do it again.
Well, let's hear what the traffic officer thinks.
I'm really undecided with Chantelle. One minute I think she's actually settling down, and then almost as soon as I think that, she's off swearing at other drivers, putting her lipstick on the phone, on the sat-nav, dancing in her chair. She's got to learn to be more relaxed. That's the last part of her journey. I thought she was actually quite good. It's really not making my decision easy.
Chantelle's driven further than ever before, but her aggression and lack of concentration is still letting her down, despite passing over the phone. So much is now riding on her third and final road trip. It's the end of the week. And a day to go before Tommy has to hand back the keys to his mum's car.
Is everyone looking good? Feeling good?
Feel good, smell good, look fresh.
Yeah. But this evening, Tommy's free to explore Essex nightlife with the usual suspects, Fraser, Ryan and Ollie. The distance to the Eclipse Club in Brentwood is 59 miles, a journey that should take an hour and 15 minutes.
You've been fucking serious. Fuck it, move, mate.
Undertaking, fuck.
What are you doing?
What the fuck are you doing, you fucking mug?
This is Tommy's toughest test yet. He's got to deal with a car full of excited lads and then a nightclub. Will he do the right thing and not drink at all?
LC07. Who the fuck is he? Give him a wanker. Fucking little mug.
They're like 90 as well.
Well, that told him. Now it's Essex. Here we come.
There it is, Eclipse on the left. Yeah, sick.
Tommy and the lads arrive in Brentwood, bang on time. The plan is to drive all the way back to Canterbury tonight. The question is, can Tommy resist the booze? That's a no then.
No, obviously, I see the boys necking their champagne and stuff, but I'm like, and I can have one or two, I'm not going to be stupid, I have some water afterwards, so I'm here to have a good time. I don't need alcohol to have a good time all the time. So I've got my personality, I've got my looks, I've got my charm. That's all I need to pull girls.
With those words, let the fun begin. With the champagne popping, the girls come flocking. But Tommy's still drinking. If you want it, I'm gonna be the fun's about to end, though, as Ryan is escorted from the club for kipping in the Kazi.
Mate, you're fucking battered.
What happened to you tonight, then, mate?
There is some spike, mate, water.
With the evening ending early, the boys get in the car and prepare to make the hour and a quarter journey home. But with the film crew suspecting that Tommy may have had too much to drink, they step in.
How much do you think you've had to drink?
I think about 3.5 glasses of champagne, but obviously I had some water obviously like in between it, so I think I'll be fine. Like, there was only small glasses as well, so
he had more than 2 glasses.
When I last spoke to him, he told me he had 6.
Tommy is asked to take a breathalyzer test.
So the legal limit is for breath,
yep,
is 35 milligrams per 100 mils. So that's a 60.
So about
So you're almost twice,
yeah,
over the legal limit, Tommy.
I didn't realise that.
So for that reason, I can't let you drive the car.
Okay, yeah, it's fine.
With the legal drink driving limit at 35 milligrams and Tommy's test result coming in at 60, he's got some bad news for the boys.
So basically, boys, just had a bit of a breathalyzer and I'm a little bit over the limit. Obviously, the thing is, I would drive, but obviously, I don't want to risk your lives. And
I think we should phone Ryan's parents.
Ryan,
give me a phone.
Fortunately for the lads, Ryan's parents only live half an hour away. Unfortunately for Ryan's parents, it's 3:30 in the morning.
Ryan's absolutely like throwing up, like massively. Is it all right if we kind of drop him home?
Well, you'll see us. There aren't many cars here.
This kid when he's probably some
thank
words.
Thank you, Mum.
Fucking idiot.
Love you, bye-bye.
Mate, you're a fucking idiot.
Wait, mate, I'm going back to his.
Despite the late hour, the lads are rescued. Tommy's got no choice but to leave his mum's vehicle overnight in the car park. Two days later, and Tommy's week-long driving test has come to an end. He's completely oblivious that his mum and dad have been assessing whether they think Tommy's ready for the keys to his own car or if he'd benefit from an advanced driving course. But they're not having to make the decision alone. Former traffic officer Judith is on her way to watch the last journey with them.
At the moment, I think Tommy's got great potential.
The final decision lies with Judith. Has Tommy proven himself responsible enough to get a car? Or will she be sending him back to driving school?
That's Judith Roberts.
Judith sits down with Maggie and AJ to watch Tommy's third and final journey.
You've been fucking serious. Undertaker tour.
No.
Cut
him
off.
No.
What kind of car?
Stay there.
Just slow down, sit behind and wait. Dangerous. Would Tommy have done that if he was on his own?
No.
I think about 3.5 glasses of champagne
bottles. Oh, okay. Then that's probably 1.5. 2 glasses, too many. But it actually takes an hour for one unit to come out of your system, and that's after 8 hours. You're looking at 11.5 hours before you should drive.
60.
That's a 60.
Now, he would have driven.
But in his defence, he wouldn't normally drive to a club.
He hasn't normally got a car.
No.
If he gets a car, he will drive, and he will think it's okay.
Well, I don't know, because I've always told him not to drink anything if he's driving. Yeah.
But he wants to drive now, and he would have driven now. Yeah.
Disappointed that Tommy was going to drink and drive. The temptation was too much for him, and he thought he was okay, but he wasn't. So...
Tommy's back at his parents' house. He thinks he's simply returning the keys to his mum's car. He has no idea what he's about to be confronted with.
Yeah, good, yeah.
Tommy, let me introduce you to Judith.
Hello, how are you doing? Right.
Judith.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
Judith's a retired police traffic officer.
Okay, yeah.
And all the time that you've been filming with your friends, me and Dad have been watching what you've
no
been
way.
Doing.
Yes,
yes,
you haven't. Yes, we have. Yes, where from?
Well, we were going to say it anyway.
Tommy sits down to be told what's at stake.
Yeah, happy and fine. Yeah. Just shocked at you two.
Well, I'm so sorry. Right, we never lie to you. We'll keep things secret, but...
That's what I think we had to do, mate.
I know, mate.
Okay. Yes, there was a potential part of a little sort of competition here, whereas you... there's possibly a prize of a car up for grabs, depending on how well you did with your driving and everything, my love.
Mm-hmm.
Or else giving you the opportunity to do an advanced driving course. But obviously that depends on what decision was made. But we've all had input into the decision. But the final decision
is up to Judith.
Lays with Judith.
OK, yeah.
It's time for Tommy to watch his week behind the wheel.
Be careful what you wish for.
So you ready for this?
Yeah, I am.
Disappointed but not surprised.
Absolutely crazy night. All my boys smashed, I'm smashed.
Oh my God.
Shocking.
Shocking, I think it is.
He hasn't actually been to any of his lectures. Have lectures tomorrow, though.
I have Thursdays off.
Tommy just wants to play Danny all the time.
I know, but he's going to have to grow up, isn't he?
Driving a little bit slow. Speed up, come on. 100? Ryan, you owe Tommy a tenner.
I've never been a father figure to my sons. If I can turn the clocks back 15 years and start again, I would love to do that.
You're almost twice over the legal limit, Tommy. I didn't realise that.
But
Tommy has the chance to plead his case. Can he convince his parents and Judith that he deserves his own car?
If you come and spend a night out with me, I'm not really defending myself, I'm just saying how it is, like...
No, Tom.
If you come out on a night out with me, then you'd understand how everyone is. It's not just me, like...
No, I mean, I know it's lots of fun for you and everything. Lee. I think you need to strike a happy medium, Tommy.
Then Tommy addresses the relationship with his dad.
Yeah, well, obviously, I said, like, obviously, we're not as close as we should be. No. Obviously, I hate that, because I said to Mum all the time, like, I do want to spend more time with you. If you are my dad, I do love you. Yeah. Obviously, in the summer... Obviously, I'll be back, and obviously at Christmas we'll have a lot more father-son time. We can go out, watch boxing and stuff together.
Yeah, great.
We can start building a better relationship than we have.
I think we should do.
I want to, mate. I've always said it to you, haven't I?
It's decision time.
There are lots of times when you're really good and very mature, and I did think, certainly on the drive to London, you dealt with that whole journey really well. And then, of course, there's the drinking.
If I was going to somewhere like Essex, I was going to drink, I wouldn't usually drive.
That's what your mum said, that you wouldn't normally.
Yeah,
but having made the decision that you were going to drive, you had two choices.
Yeah.
You either, before you go into that nightclub, say, I'm not drinking.
Yeah.
Or, I am going to get a skinful, I'm going to have a great night,
yeah.
and I'm getting a cab home.
Yeah.
but you cannot get in the car behind the wheel.
No.
If you've had, I mean, really, zero tolerance should be in this country.
Yeah.
Now, I would plumb for the driving course because I think you especially would really benefit from it. Mm-hmm. But I really do think you would learn.
So it's back to driving school for Tommy. His speeding and potential drink driving has scuppered his chances of owning a car. For now.
Obviously, yeah, the opportunity of having a car has gone, but obviously now I'm doing this advanced driving course, obviously when I do get a car, I'm going to be twice a safer driver than I already am, which is really good. So I'm happy. Come on, come in. We'll group hug.
Group hug.
Love you. You're right, yeah?
Yeah.
Sweet.
While Tommy's week's over, Chantelle still has an outside chance of getting her own car. And like Tommy, her final trip is also out clubbing. Her and Gabby are off to Gatecrasher in Birmingham. Birmingham is 75 miles from Thornbury, and if they miss the traffic on the M5, they should arrive in an hour and a half. It's 7:30 p.m, so they ought to be there by 9. Unlike Tommy and the lads, Chantelle's wisely booked a hotel for the evening so that she can have a drink and let her hair down.
We're on the M5, baby! Woo!
The journey should be easy from here, but this is Chantelle we're talking about.
No, he ain't going in the fast lane. He's slow as fuck. Hang on. What? I ain't even got a horn. Fuck.
Shan, I'm really proud of you. You haven't got your phone out once.
I know. I have to keep it away. I've made a vow to myself not to have my phone out. Because what if I killed someone?
Is this really the same mobile-addicted Chantelle that started out a week ago? And for once, they've made good time as they hit Birmingham.
We're nearly there, Gab.
I know. OK, enter roundabout, go 170 foot, take the second exit. Oh, it says we're 8 minutes away.
Shut up.
It's 9 p.m. and they're just a mile from the hotel.
Yeah! Woo! We've done it! Morrison's. It just continues to say bare lift. Does it say a roundabout anywhere? Go all the way down. I'm just gonna keep left, you know?
Enter roundabout, take second exit.
Where's a roundabout?
I don't know.
Oh, we're at Morrison's again.
I know, I think we have to take the second exit now.
Hang on, I think we got the wrong way. No. Oh no, should I just go this way?
Bare left. No. Take the second exit on.
Fucking Morrison's again!
Third time lucky, all right? At least we'll be able to find Morrison's.
Almost walking distance from the hotel, the girls have been driving around completely lost for an hour and a half. It's the last straw for Chantelle.
I give up.
And I think it's not helpful because I don't know how to drive.
Digging deep, Chantelle tries another route.
I'm fuming. I'm absolutely fuming. There is the fucking Comfort Inn!
After driving around in circles for an unbelievable hour and 45 minutes, they finally arrive at the hotel and check in. No time to waste. Chantelle's getting tanked up on her usual tipple. But sensibly, she isn't driving again tonight.
Oh, never again. Everyone's like, oh, Birmingham's well easy. Is it Eck? I'm just going to say to the taxi driver, can you just take us to Gatecrasher, please? He'll know, won't he? He'll know. I'm pissed.
Two days later, an ex-traffic cop Judith's driving to Bristol for Chantelle's final viewing with her dad Mike and his mate Mark.
The last drive will probably be the one that sways me
at the moment I'm very much on the fence, and I'm not sure whether she deserves to have a car of her own.
It's crunch time. Unless Chantelle has shown she can curb her road rage and stop using her phone permanently, she won't be getting the car.
Checking the mirrors.
Mm. Oh, I think her driving is actually quite good. You know, she's...
She do look in it, yeah.
But I like the fact now that Gabby's actually got the phone and that she's not on the phone, because that, to me, is my biggest bugbear.
That was mine. Mm.
The first drive, I thought, uh-oh, we've got somebody who's completely irresponsible.
Yeah.
And she's in charge of a lethal weapon, and the lipstick and the eating and the swearing and the road rage and the anger and the animation. It was everything that you don't want in a young person. Second drive, very slightly better. But then the last drive, I saw a great improvement. She settled down. There was less road rage. There was less phone. There was less distractions. Mike, what do you think?
To the first two journeys.
You weren't happy.
I weren't happy. And I weren't happy with her. And I really hard to keep my mouth shut. Because she didn't, obviously, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I always tell her every time, keep on the phone, watch the speed. Yeah. I always tell her that anyway. Her attitude has changed vastly, not just to driving, but towards life itself. Mm-hmm. And I think that's great for me. And I think the more practice she gets in the car, the better she'd become.
It's really not an easy decision for me.
Chantelle's heading home, believing she's simply returning her dad's car. She has no idea what's really in store for her.
Hi, love. A bit of a shock here, look.
Oh my god!
Yeah? Alright? Oh, what's the matter, love? Didn't expect this, did you? No.
This lady said this is Judith. She's a police officer with the.
Retired.
Traffic.
Oh and god.
We've been having a little.
We get locked away from our
neighbour
or something.
Look at you over the past week. We've been spying on you a little bit.
Oh, God. All right.
Chantelle's about to see her antics on the road.
Fucking silly pricks!
Oh, I'm sorry.
Silly pricks!
It gets better.
Do you like yourself being like that?
That looks disgusting, doesn't it?
What's he doing? Yes. I don't have a clue where I'm going. I don't
know.
Have to
on the phone.
On the phone.
My hands are off the wheel!
Yes, your hands are off the wheel, but you're steering with your knees.
Fuck! My language is appalling, isn't it?
Yes.
I just opened my eyes up a little bit as... maybe I'm not as much of a sick driver as I make out I am. My road rage is because I don't have anywhere else to vent, like, my anger. Just after talking to Gabby about loads of stuff, like... just what's going on in my life at the moment, like, I'm just not as angry. Alright, I'm on the phone and I've done my makeup and stuff. I'm not a dangerous driver, like, I just, like, I make a couple of mistakes and I've kind of realised, like, how dangerous it is to go on the phone, like...
You think this is something you could change?
Massively. I'll say it, yeah, I would like the money for the car because I've done my test, I've done all my lessons. It took me so long to get there. And it just feels like I'm doing it all over again. But all I do is just have my phone out and then...
You've learned your lesson on that phone now, have you?
Like, I just...
Well, we've seen a fast improvement, haven't we? But we have come to the decision and we're going to give you the money for another car.
So no more phones.
Oh, make me upset now. Right.
In the end, by ditching her mobile and becoming a calmer driver, Chantelle's proved she's ready to get back on the road again in her very own car.
So happy. Thanks. Right, I'm dying for a cup of tea, so I'm going to have a tea. See you later.
A week later, and Tommy's back at driving school, being put through his paces with some advanced lessons.
He's off the gas, gently. Car
parking back. Smooth power wide.
The trainer was really nice, taught me some new things about the car I didn't know before. So yeah, it was a really enjoyable day.
Meanwhile, back in Bristol, the day's also arrived for Chantelle to pick up the keys to her own car.
Oh, look at the light.
It's not quite a Katie Price Range Rover, but it'll be perfect to get around town.
Oh, I love that. Thanks, Dad.
All right, same. Nice, isn't it, eh?
Yeah, I like it a lot. Oh, yes, please. Oh! I've got a new car, and it's lush, and it's got central lock-in and electric windows.
Chantelle is enjoying her new car and no longer uses her mobile phone whilst driving. Next time on Barely Legal Drivers, we meet two teens who like to party.
What are you doing?
Hey! Don't fucking start before I punch you in your face.
Do you know how fucking hard it is to drive and you guys aren't telling me where to go?
Tonight we're ending a fight for definite.
Oh my God.
He's done a lot of good things, but he's also done a lot of bad things.
Yeah, just keep going.
My mom's gonna go mad.
Fuck college tomorrow! This is life.
3. Jessie says getting road rage sitting on my sofa in my living room. Katie tweets considering handing back my license so I never encounter the drivers on Barely Legal Drivers. While Tara says watching now with my eyes covered, lol. Go online to the BBC 3 website and have your say via email or on our Facebook page or Twitter.